Thank you for joining Auto Network Reports, and good morning, good morning, good morning. I hope you brought your coffee and donuts to our new time and day, 10 a.m., trying to wake up at 10 a.m. and look at these gorgeous faces and whatever these other guys are. It's kind of difficult. It was kind of difficult.
Well, I wish we would get started with an objectification of my face.
I said, ladies, but that's okay.
Oh, I see. Uh-oh.
We have a technical issue, but that's all right. We'll see what happens with that. Anyway, this is Auto Network Reports. I want to thank you for joining in our new time slot, 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. We're going to see how this works for everybody. But as always, please, if you know an African-American male, 30 years or older, make sure he visits his urologist and get that PSA exam. I always say it's that little prick that could possibly save his life. We're going to have a discussion about what's happening with CES, but before we get into that, let's do what we're supposed to be doing here on the show, and that's car reviews. Let's talk about what you guys are driving. Greg, what are you in, or what have you driven this week?
This week, I'm actually in something somewhat familiar, the Mazda CX-5 Signature. 2.5-liter, 4-cylinder engine. It's a Mazda. It's rock solid. Averages combined of about 23 to the gallon city highway driving. The one thing I like about Mazda is they're reliable. They start, they go. And there's no surprises there in terms of performance or failure. If I have a complaint with it, it's the back seat. There's not enough footwell space for people in the back seat. If I'm in the driver's seat, and I'm only 5'8" tall, so you figure that's pretty cramped footwell.
Roosevelt, do we have time to ask questions on this new format?
If you feel like you need to ask him a question, go right ahead.
Well, it serves two purposes. One, I can ask the question, and two, I won't be known as just another pretty face.
So, well, you're going to have a chance to talk about your car, but go ahead.
Greg, you will never be known as just a pretty face.
Greg, have you driven the CX-50, Mazda CX-50?
Yes, night and day difference.
Well, I know, yeah. I was going to say, with that night and day difference, do you understand or can you see the reason for there to be both in a Mazda showroom?
That's one of the questions we asked the manufacturer when we got into the CX-50 at a product event. And it's like they recognize that the 50 will cannibalize some of their sales from the CX-5. By the way, the CX-50 is built in Huntsville, Alabama, whereas the CX-5 is still built over in Japan.
And
I think that for those who want to go off-roading, be a little more adventurous, the CX-50 is probably your better investment. For those who are just doing city driving, you know, on paved roads, CX-5 would be fine. I like the 50 better simply for the handling and the response, especially when pulling some tough grades.
Very good. Well, thank you.
Does that answer your question?
You bet.
Hey, Dawn. Wake up, Dawn. I know it's early. You there?
Oh, sorry. I'm sorry.
Go right ahead. What have you driven recently?
Okay, so I actually got two cars this week.
And how about one?
Okay, let's do one. I got the 2023 Nissan Z. I just got it yesterday, so I'm still getting acquainted with it. But I absolutely love this car. It is like fast, it's gorgeous, and major eye candy. Like, I took it for a spin, and like, people were like on the side of me, honking the horn and everything. I was like, whoa, saying it's a cool car. So, basically, you have the option of a 6-speed manual or a 9-speed automatic. I did test out the manual a couple months ago, but they dropped off the automatic, and I love it just as much as I love the manual. It's only offered in rear wheel drive, and I think that's because people want to do burnouts and stuff, you know. They can't do that with all wheel drive, I don't think so. It has a 3.0 liter V6 twin turbo engine. As far as the horsepower, you get 400 HP torque, 350, And the starting manufacturing price is $39,990. They dropped off the performance to me, and that's $49,990. And you can put it in like three drive modes, which is normal, enhanced, and sport. And I kept mine in sport. I mean, I keep it in sport. So I like the sound, and it goes a little faster or whatever.
See, I had to put notes down because the dang Maroney's so small. I couldn't see what it said, so I had to.
Hey, you should see me with this giant.
I would have put my readers on just yet.
Hey, Chris, you should see me with my dad's giant magnifying glass on. I'm not trying to read these Monroney's.
I was like, dang it, I forgot what it.
Go ahead, Chris, since you're here.
Okay, since I'm here, first, Dawn, I can agree with you that the looks you get with that Z are crazy. I had just gotten out of it last week. And so since you talked about that this week, I'm going to talk about something that gets attention from all pretty faces. Well, we'll see. It was the 2022 Mercedes-Benz.
Woo! Oh, nice.
Metris cargo van.
Yeah.
Now this particular van, it was the 126 inch wheelbase, so it wasn't exceptionally large or anything like that. It's made for, I assume, small businesses and things like that. You know, you do deliveries and all. My kids referred to it as the Amazon van, and then of course my youngest then was like, she had other descriptions of it because this van does not have any windows in the back at all. So, you know, you can kind of use your imagination as to what other description you might have for this type of van driving through the neighborhood. But that being said, I mean, it was a straight, pretty hardcore cargo van. I mean, it had the partition behind the two front seats. So, you know, there was no pass through at all. It was literally just the cockpit in the front and then the cargo area in the back. Obviously, it can be outfitted with all sorts of things that you might need for whatever your daily business is. But this particular van, it was bare bones in the back. It has a 2-liter four-cylinder engine, turbocharged, made 208 horsepower and 258 pound-feet of torque. And actually, that wasn't bad. It's front-wheel drive, and that was adequate power for a vehicle like that. It drove well. It does have Mercedes previous gen interior fitments, so you're not going to get the big screens and all that kind of stuff like the newer Benzes have, or even like the current gen Sprinter van has. This Metris van, you can tell that it does have some previous gen fitments to it, but you know, it's a decent van. Fuel economy was 19 city, 23 highway, and 21 combined. And I was able to get an average of 23 miles to the gallon, which, again, not too bad if you're spending a lot of time in this van as your mobile office.
Great.
Did I give the price? Didn't give the price.
No.
Price was, oh gosh, I gotta get the readers out again. $42,560.
Okay.
$42,000.
So we haven't had a car on yet that was 30, huh? Less than 30 or 30, mid-30s.
Okay. Not gonna either, I don't think.
Yeah, that's that seems to be the trend for carrying over in 2023 is the price of cars is still up there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Teia, how about you? What were you driving?
I have the Kia Telluride X Pro I have this week. Last week I had the Acura MDX, but I've driven this one before and I fell in love with the Telluride probably a couple years ago. It was what signaled to me that Kia was doing a brand shift and that they were like, oh, we're going to play in the luxury space. We're going to go there. And this one just reminds me that they're doing a really good job with it. Really, really good job with it. Love the space inside. Love the flexibility of the seats. Love the placement of stuff. If nothing's complicated to reach, nothing's really out of place, weird to navigate, drive modes are not hidden inside of the nav screen. it's just really, really well done. Just a really well done vehicle. I was like, dang, I could keep this one. Okay. actually keep this one. So, but one thing, like I have tall kids, my big kids are tall. So the test for me is that second and third row is to stick my big kids, because they're right around 6 feet, in that third row. And there's space for them to sit back there without their knees being in the second row, or to get in, sit in the second seat and not have somebody's knees in the back of my driver's seat. You know, that is huge, huge life things. Things, easy fasten seat belts, easy cup holders where the kid can actually put the cup in there by himself and you're not doing some contortionist move to pass a drink to somebody. I like it. I would say ideally suited for a family, or maybe 2, 3, 4, somewhere around there. But also for people who are, we were talking about the rising cost of cars. People who are used to playing with the luxury vehicles, but then are sick of the cost rising and still want some of those features, those creature comforts, to bring it back down so that you can be in a little bit more of a cost-effective price bracket.
Thanks, Roosevelt. Am I the anchor on this? With
respect to,
can I take as much time as I need?
All right, ahead. We're on the internet. We're not bound by time and space.
And let me go ahead and open it up in advance to questions. If anyone has any questions, I'll certainly try and answer them. And finally, Chris, are you going to take notes with me?
No, that was just strictly for the minuscule writing on my Monroney. You know, everything else I got up here.
Fair enough. Well, I am in a truck as opposed to a car.
Ooh.
It's a Toyota's Tundra Capstone. I haven't done the necessary research before writing the review with respect to what Capstone itself represents. I can tell you that it's a luxury trim level. And I'd like to describe Toyota's new Tundra. It was redesigned for 2022. I'm driving to 2023 as 3 tons of fun. But quite frankly, there are fun Toyotas on today's Toyota showroom. The Tundra is not one of them. It is full size, with all of the capability that that implies, including 12,000 pounds of towing capacity. But it is awkward in its handling. The twin turbo V6 with hybrid assist resonates. It's visceral. It accelerates very, very well. But the platform itself, frankly, it has the clumsiness of a heavy duty truck without obviously a heavy duty capability. I've been either lucky or unlucky enough to have owned 2 trucks over the last 3 years, propelled in part by the COVID lockdown. And the F-150 felt considerably more nimble than this half-ton Tundra does. And a Dodge, or rather a Ram 2500 heavy duty, felt no less clumsy than this Tundra does and had a heck of a lot more capability. So I'm confident you can find a Tundra that you'd like in the spec that you'd like it, if you're a Toyota loyalist. But if I were shopping Toyota, I'd wait for a redesigned Tacoma, which is coming very soon, get the additional refinement that that will afford you. Potentially, it comes with a twin turbo V6, and have something on the order of $45,000 invested rather than the $75,000 that Toyota's asking for this fully equipped Tundra.
$75,000?
$75,000. You could buy Don's Z and come close to getting Greg's CX-5 for that $75,000.
Yeah.
But that would be silly.
Well, let you all know that the prices you were talking about were nothing. This is a $206,000 Mercedes-Benz AMG SL 63 Roadster. When you saw me, I was in it.
Oh,
I did drive
pretty.
It.
That I love it.
As a 4-liter V8 bi-turbo, as you know, AMG engines are handcrafted. This is handcrafted. 577 horsepower, 590 pound-feet of torque. AMG 9-speed automatic transmission with paddle shifters. This thing will fly, but you really just want to cruise. This is a cruiser. You know, you go downtown, you drop the top, and you're just cruising. You talk about turning heads. This turned bodies completely around.
you'll be flexing in this car, like you flexing this car.
The exterior is an alpine gray. The interior is a tartufo brown with black Napa leather trimming, with also has some aluminum trimming in there, which is nice as well. Like I said, $206,600, 14 miles per gallon, 21 miles, that's city, 21 highway, 16 combined. If you're worrying about the fuel economy, you shouldn't be looking at this car.
I'm trying for that.
Close your eyes. This thing's supposed to seat four. I don't think so. Tia, you'd never be able to get your kids in the back seat of this unless one turns sideways. It has everything on it.
If you have a car like that, you don't allow your kids in it.
No, this thing has everything on it that you could possibly think of, except
those are some decorative cooler seats.
Now, but Chris, I understand Roosevelt has more years of experience in this industry, but how is it that he gets a $200,000 Roadster and you get a $40,000 van?
I tell you, man. I tell you, it's crazy, right?
Hey, Chris.
The trunk in my van was bigger than the trunk in that car, though.
At this point, Chris, you just might want to reevaluate your professional goals.
or my friends, apparently.
Chris, when they delivered this car, I'm like everybody else. How in the world did I get this?
I would have stood there and grinned at people. I would have just stood there and
I would have been doing the princess wave, like, hello.
You know the sad thing about getting this car when I did? It rained three of the 6 days that I had it. So, and I'm the type of person, if it's below zero outside and I get a convertible, I will drop the top, roll the windows up, put a hat and a scarf and a heavy coat on and turn on the heat. And it's just like a sunny day to me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Me too.
Roosevelt, I have that exact same issue where I always know when I'm getting the nice convertibles because it's always wintertime.
Yeah.
Every year I can give you the forecast, you know, Chris's almanac, where it's like, hey, it's gonna be snowy today, guys, because I've got a nice convertible this week.
Gosh, no, with me, when I get a press car, it's guaranteed to rain either the day I get it or the day after.
So you get it when it's dirty, right?
It's unbelievable. I mean, in all the years that I've been doing this, no matter where I have lived, no joke, it has rained. And I hate to have to clean up a new car in the first.
That was me last week with the Z.
Yeah, I hate to have to clean up a new car. But anyway, let's move right into the CES. I'm sure you all have read everything. I don't know. I think Tia is probably the only one that attended CES. Is that right?
No, I did virtual, but I didn't go.
Oh, you didn't go? Okay.
No.
Oh, I thought you were there. But anyway, what are your comments about CES specifically on the automotive side? What is it that you like, you saw that you like, that you didn't like?
That Ram truck. Okay. So I remember thinking I remember when electric truck was a novelty idea. Now it's the race to create something sustainable. We see them here. I see the Lightning out here. And I mean, I live outside of Dallas. So people do truck things with the trucks out here. We still have people riding their horses down the side of the highway. But you want an electric truck to do what you think it's going to do what it says it's going to do. Just like Dave was talking about the towing capacity on that Tundra. You want your electric truck to be able to do what you think it's going to do. You need to be able to tow. You need to be able to throw stuff in the back. You need to not worry that it's going to be able to function like you expect it to. Because otherwise, what's the point? I'm kind of excited to see what it's going to look like.
You know, electric trucks in Texas, my only concern is how do you scare the cows off the road when they're crossing?
You don't. You wait.
You have no engine to ram. There's no exhaust note.
You wait.
And I lived in Texas. I lived in Texas as well, so I understand truck loving in Texas. You know, I think it's probably the only place in the country where they still drive around with guns in the windows, in the rear window. But anyway, what were you saying? Greg?
You haven't been to Alabama. My concern about the electric trucks in Texas is real simple. With a flaky electrical grid like Texas has, I'd be worried about being able to charge the daggone thing. But I mean, I'm glad Ram has finally gotten into the electrified space. It took mm-hmm. them long enough. They were the last domestic nameplate to actually come up with an electrified platform. And part of that was because Sergio Marchionne didn't like electric vehicles. May he rest in peace. But yeah, I think the Ram truck was the big thing out of CES. The other thing was Mercedes' announcement about setting up their own charging network. You get more and more OEMs talking about setting up their own networks. I was just reading in Automotive News this morning about some things that General Motors and Ford are going to try to do with electric companies about working together to manage electric use. The real thing with electrification is going to be the network. How can the network survive? How can the grid survive to support it? And that's going to be the big challenge, not only for the OEM, but for the average consumer and for the utility companies. We've got to either put up or shut up at this point. You know, they were saying, yeah, let's go with electric vehicles because, you know, they're thinking I must make more money, you know, selling electricity. But if your grid can't support it or cost of installing infrastructure is so high that a lot of folks say, never mind, then, you know, it's an exercise in futility.
If Roosevelt, if I can speak to the larger question of CES itself, I've not attended. And I certainly have a level of curiosity with regard to the content, but I've not attended. There are places I'd rather be in January than Las Vegas. But what bothers me about CES are the number of OEMs running to it or rushing to it that then go and ignore a major auto show. They can find the budget for CES, which again is Consumer Electronics Show, but can't find the money or have the institutional wherewithal to support the Detroits or the Chicagos or the New Yorks or the LAs that are auto shows catering to an auto audience. So if you're going to plug into CES, great, more power to you. But don't do it with the money that you might have spent at a traditional auto show. Don't do it with the money that you might have spent on traditional automotive journalism in, if not hosting us, at least inviting us to those auto shows. So I know that sounds a little bit of a bah humbug, and I know we're past the point of Christmas, but I'm sorry, I'm just not getting it. Peugeot had an absolutely gorgeous concept at CES, mm-hmm. while admitting Peugeot's not returning to the States, and we won't see a Peugeot brand that we can buy. So I understand it's a global audience, but give me a break, please. I'll more happily return to my Tundra than I will CES.
Tell us how you really feel about it, man.
Yeah, one of the concerns about CES, but before I get into that, COVID has changed everything. When COVID hit and there was a major shutdown, the whole world changed overnight, basically. And the auto industry had to make decisions as to, okay, how are we going to still function, get cars to people, get car service, but more importantly, get new product in front of consumers. They were forced to go into virtual shows like this one, which we've been doing forever. They were not prepared to do it. If you see some of the earlier shows, they were horrible. It's, you know, but they've gotten better at it, and they have found that people will watch virtual car launches. So Dave, I don't think we're ever going to see all the manufacturers going back to the traditional auto show, which I enjoyed because, you know, there are only about three of them that I love to attend anyway. But if you look at the CES crowd, the other thing that still concerns me about people getting together in groups, if you watch any of the video, most of those people still did not wear masks. Mm-hmm. And COVID is alive and well. And I've mentioned this before, everybody that I have known that's gone to Vegas over the last 6 to 12 months have come back with COVID.
Interesting.
It's unbelievable. So it's going to be interesting to see how that fares with CES. But the, you know, to go back to your question about auto shows, I agree with you. I think the manufacturers should go back to the in-person auto shows. It gives all of us an opportunity to interact directly with CEOs and executives of car companies, which I love to do. I don't do one-on-one interviews at auto shows because I'm not one of the scrum type people. I prefer to do that on the ride and drives where you can do an easy one-on-one. But anyway, that's my two cents.
I think your point about the COVID outbreaks in Vegas are spot on. I mean, I was there this summer, came back with a case of COVID. And someone says, hey, you want to go to CES? No way in hell do I want to get any leads right now. But I think the bigger issue is a lot of OEMs have complained about the cost of doing a launch at an auto show. They have the costs have gone up, and especially in Detroit, they were getting killed on labor costs because these guys would start working on the setups the day after Thanksgiving. And with the show in January, they were doing Thanksgiving, Christmas, and New Year's, and the labor costs were just getting out of hand. Now, this is not to say I'm anti-union. This is a union household, but some of that was just craziness. Now, what I've seen several OEMs start to do is, okay, there's a show in New York. They may do an event, but they'll do it outside of the show at an event space and say, put the car on the show floor, but we're not going to do a big presentation there because they're just getting killed on labor costs. But I agree that there's something missing, that synergy is missing when you have a virtual launch or something outside of the traditional auto show where folks can ask them hard questions of the executives, like, what were you thinking when you decided to add 5 extra tons of chrome to this vehicle? And let's face it, you know, it's kind of hard to do that on a virtual when I'm sitting in Atlanta, you guys are somewhere in Germany and cars in Las Vegas.
Yeah, you know,
of course, I'll get more invitations to the car things, but that's okay.
You know, I know we're all the manufacturers now are looking at these cars as computers on wheels, and I'm sure CES is what's drawing them to that particular crowd. But I like to talk about what's happening now. You know, it's nice that we're going to have all these EVs coming and everybody's talking about EVs. You just can't go out there and get an EV today that you want.
No.
You know, but like Dave said, you can go out and get a gasoline Tundra.
And they hope you do.
Yeah, and enjoy it now rather than what's going to happen with the future. You know, BMW has this nice dashboard. Well, they removed the dashboard. Now they're going to use the front windshield screen pretty much to project any kind of graphics you need about the automobile. But you're not going to, you probably will never see that in our lifetime.
I think it's a different take on race on Sunday, sell on Monday, you know, where it's like, all right, well, we're going to tease people into our brand with this stuff that they'll never have access to. And then hopefully once they actually pay attention to our brand, they'll find something else that they'll sell.
That they love.
Yeah.
But I think it's more of a concept. I think CES is more a concept. So like at the actual auto shows that I go to, I love the stuff I see on the floor. I love to be able to get hands-on in a vehicle, touch, feel, experience. There's just something missing when you do it virtually. That experience is not the same. So
I agree with that. It's not the same.
You know, it's not the same. I hope there's a blend of, I think virtual is not going anywhere, but I do think that there's something about being hands-on in a vehicle makes it real. Practical.
Yeah. Well, the time at the Detroit Auto Show was Sunday was concept day. And you'd roll in there on Sunday afternoon, you go to the concept, all these wonderful concepts laid out. And then Monday and Tuesday would be nothing but new product. Now the chunks of the industry has changed.
At Mercedes-Benz.
We'll tell you about what we call mild It's a long march trying to cover all that, you know, in Detroit. But yeah, the concepts are nice, but don't show me something I can't have. It's like being a teenager, being introduced to the prettiest girl on the cheerleading squad, and know you're never going to get a date with her.
unless you ask. The concept on the first date.
Actually, Greg, I did date the prettiest girl on the cheerleading squad. And Roosevelt, could I take just a moment to say hi to Laura Scarupa?
Go ahead. Go ahead.
If of course she's watching, she may not.
Yeah, she probably is. You know, we have the early morning crowd. We have a lot of people this morning watching.
I'm so glad I didn't sleep on that.
I talk about Detroit. You know, I used to go to Detroit all the time. It was one of my favorite shows, other than the fact that it was in the dead of winter, which was. But, you know, we had, I think the highest point, Detroit had something like over 7,500 registered journalists attending the show.
Wow.
Ooh,
they had, I used to shoot every press launch by myself. Until they got up to 33, and then they started doing overlaps where you had to make a decision as to which press event you were going to go to. Mm-hmm. The maximum I was able to do was 31 by myself. Remember those days, Greg, when we used to save space on the risers?
Oh, God, yes. Exhausting. Roosevelt would be bringing his gear. I'd run ahead and hold a space for him so he could get his gear set. And I was still doing pencil and paper in those days. So that's one less thing I had to worry about. And then I'd run ahead, you know, just as press conference rat was winding down, I'm running ahead to the next one. And it was like, you know, no.
But those days are gone. We're going to see more. We're going to see more, like Tia said, you're going to see a combination. I think the last auto show I went to was Chicago. And Chicago used to be the same way, hustle and bustle. And I spent more time rushing to the next podium, and then I had to wait. And I'm saying, what's the rush for? Because they didn't have as many exhibitors like Dave was saying. So you had a lot of time. You could almost eat lunch between presentations. It was, and that slow pace killed me.
Well, this year Chicago, there's going to be the concept garages on the first day. I love the concept garage.
Yeah, technology garage.
And, technology, concept technology. And then after that.
I do too. I can't wait.
The next day is, I think it's the full day of press conferences from 9 until 4.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, lessons learned from previous shows. One, do not wear heels because, quite frankly, I'll be hobbling around like a new horse by the end of the day.
Now you're telling me not to wear heels.
Yes, now, let's see, what else have I learned?
Real quickly, Tia.
Go ahead, Dave. I knew you were leaning into the screen. I know you couldn't pass that one up.
In almost 400 shows, Roosevelt, is this the first time we've referenced high heels?
Yes.
Okay. can we get a new hashtag, maybe?
This is a first.
Lessons learned. Things I've learned that I'm learning on the road. I was like, because you start out, you're like, I'm going to be fabulous. I'm going to cover. And then, by the end, you're like, look, I can't walk. Don't talk to me. I can't look.
Also, it's chilly in there. And like, when I went the last time, I had like a t-shirt on. I had to go back upstairs. I was so cold. You know, I had to get a jacket.
So this year I'm going to stay. I want, leave at the end of press day. But I want to see. I want to talk to some consumers this year. I want to hear what people who are coming into the show who aren't press, what they're saying. Like, I want to hear that part of the story, what they're excited to talk about, what they want to see. Because I usually leave to come back home right before they get there, before they open the doors to the public. This year, I want to stay at least for a little while and maybe interview some people and see what. Because I know what I get out of it. I love having all those brands there at the same spot so I can get lots of content in the same spot, same day, and then I can use it throughout the year. But what do people, what's the percentage of people whose actual intent is to buy? Like they're going to shop for a car? Or is it more of an enthusiast experience? Like what's driving people to come.
Well, and over the years, Chicago's always been a truck and SUV-based show with some sedans, but trucks and SUVs are always the stars there. It's going to be interesting this year with all the electric vehicles out there as to, you know, what we'll see on the show floor.
I always like, when writing about the Chicago show, I always like to channel Carl Sandburg whenever possible. And he regarded Chicago as the city of big shoulders. And I think that speaks to trucks.
Yes, yeah, city of big shoulders.
Yeah. And the Metris cargo van.
Well, I think they're evolving because, like Houston here in Texas, they're doing this year, they're doing Houston auto and boat. And they are combining the two of those shows into one show.
Oh, that's cool.
Which will be interesting to see how that all kind of flows together and works out.
That require a lot of space.
Yeah,
it is. It's at the NRG. It is a lot of space. But wow. This is Texas. We got a lot of space. We got a lot of space. Which,
and you're so close to the water, you put away anyway.
We're landlocked. Well, I'm landlocked up here, but we got lakes. We just make them. I had an EV 2 weeks ago, and so I have a level 2 charger in the backyard connected to the tiny house, but I was out in public with it, like in Dallas. I had to pick up Zenora from school, and so of course, you know, I already know that I'm supposed to stick this thing, and Roosevelt, we talked about this, I'm supposed to stick it on a charger before, like overnight, right? We know this, but obviously I didn't do it by what I'm leading up to. So we had to go into Dallas to go look for chargers, right? What happened was is the vast majority of the public chargers that we found were behind locked gates.
Mm.
So you know how the car will tell you where there's a charger. And it'll be like, you know, you're 1.2 miles from your charger. And then you get there and it's behind a locked gate. And I'm like, sup? Okay. And so you slowly watch. It was when we had that freak snowstorm here, the weather where it changed dramatically and got stupid cold here. That's when this happened. And I'm watching the range slowly creep down, you know, to scary points. And it was like, you know, you should charge this vehicle because we were down to like 22 miles. And I was like, I know better.
Have you experienced the car tells you where to go, whatever. But then once you get there, all of them are broken. All the stations are broken.
Broken like or somebody else is using it.
Well, when I went, they have 4 that I usually go to, and the car actually told me go there, but they were all broken. And then when I called, you know, the charging station people or whatever, they didn't even know they were broken. And so I got down to like 15 miles and finally found one that worked. I was so scared. Talk about range anxiety.
I have a personal rule with EV press vehicles is that if I know I'm going to be home for at least an hour, I plug it in no matter what. I don't care if I got to go back out again later. What's that?
I live in an apartment, so it's kind of,
Yeah, no, I can understand that. Yeah, but just because, you know, every little trickle matters with those things.
It does.
And unfortunately,
I was so scared.
I'm like, I don't have a level 2, so I'm literally trickle charging every time. So literally, if I know I'm going to be home for at least an hour, plug it in, get that extra 2 miles of range or whatever it's going to give me and do that. Then that way, at least if I'm home all day, if I don't go back out for hours or what have you, at least I know that I've been topping off again, as opposed to, you know, the times where I used to just let it go and then it gets depleted down to nothing. And then you're stuck, you know, you're like, what do we do now?
I scared myself enough to where we'll go through the effort of driving around to the back to open the gate and plug it in. I was like, sup.
Range anxiety is still very
real.
Don raised the valid point that with so many people in our society who do live in rental and family units, that's the big challenge, you know, because these are the folks you really want to embrace electrification. If there's no place to charge, then, you know, what the heck's going on? And that is the real problem. For example, to put in a level 3 charger or even level 2 chargers in your apartment complex will probably cost the owners close to $100,000 to run that much power line up in there and then set it up. And that's literally the craziness. You know, as we make the transition to electrification, consciousness of how much time you have to be able to find a station, a public station, and charge the vehicle up. And I'm going to take a swipe at some of the auto companies and the dealers who say, oh, yeah, we can come to our dealership and charge up. But your charging station is around back at the dealership.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that's it's like, what in the heck are you thinking? And we have to really, if we go electrification, we have to put pressure not only on the electric companies to provide the charging systems, but also the charging station operators to ensure their systems are up and operating. And who's going to be training the folks to do the repair? I can't seem to get a straight answer on that from any of the EVgo's, charge points, Electrify Americas.
Well, so I think, go ahead. Final comment.
One of our new schools here has actually one of the automotive tech programs is teaching the kids how to work on, like, it's literally dedicated to electric vehicles is one of the classes programs that the kids are working on. And these are 17, 16, 17 year olds. And that's what they're learning, how to repair these things.
Oh, that's cool.
I was like, interesting. Well played. Way to get a group of kids who are going to be instantly employable.
Crazy.
Just like that.
We could probably do a show on our experiences as journalists driving different types of EVs. And that may be something that we can do in the future. But I want to take the time to go ahead, Dave.
Well, I was just going to say, before we leave EVs and trucks, I wasn't at CES, but I was at the Peterson Museum in LA over the holiday. And this is the Peterson Automotive Museum. And they have a specific Tesla exhibit on the ground floor devoted everything potentially you'd want to know about Tesla. Had my first viewing of the Cybertruck live, which obviously has been played in the media almost as long as the Dodge Viper was played in the media back in the late 80s, early 90s. Anyway, had not seen it visually in the flesh. I got to tell you, AMG shouldn't build that thing. OMG should build that thing.
I was waiting to hear your thoughts.
is that thing, at least in its current iteration, ever butt ugly, if I can say butt ugly?
Oh, my God.
Yes.
And we thought Greg was the only one who had those thoughts about the brand.
Well, you're never
getting them on the show now.
No, moving right along.
for
all you Tesla
that?
Lovers.
Yeah, that's all I have to say about the Cybertruck.
But anyway, I want to thank all of you, especially the panelists, taking the time out of your busy morning to sit in on our new time schedule. You can. Next Wednesday at 10 a.m., we'll be right back here talking about cars and hopefully not about the Tesla Cybertruck. But please visit the website or Facebook page of each one of the panelists. Please subscribe, show them some love, hugs, and kisses. And I don't know what they're doing now on Twitter, what's going on over there. But anyway, as always, please buckle up, don't drink and drive. Buckle up, don't text and drive. And as Frank says, buckle up, don't stream and drive. See you next time. Thank you, folks. Appreciate it. Enjoy.
Bye-bye. Thank you.